Since the dawn of time, man has thrived on competition. As a species, we are the foremost experts on comparing ourselves to others. Given the chance, we will almost certainly find a way to compete against not only other beasts, but our fellow man as well, for a chance at superiority. But what is the catalyst that drives us to form rivalries? Is it a proclivity towards conflict? Or do we seek validation in the form of victory over others? Whatever the reason, this unmistakable bond forged between opponents has stood the test of time, and sunk itself into all manner of media. It should come as no surprise that rivalry is plentiful in the realm of video games. Sonic and Shadow, Scorpion and Sub-Zero, Phoenix Wright and Miles Edgeworth, literally any rival in a Pokemon game. This list is extensive and serves to prove that people like rivals. Most games need a proper rivalry in order to function, someone to set the bar and encourage players to be better. The issue is, the topic of rivalries in games is incredibly broad and fluid. The nature of said character is highly dependent on genre. So in this video, I will be examining the rival in the context of one particular genre, character action, and explaining what makes them tick. The end goal is simple, crafting a concrete definition of a good rival. Before we can establish our working definition of a rival, we must first define the genre in question. Character action is a subgenre of action game that places its emphasis on combat, or as the name implies, the character's action. The term hack and slash also gets thrown around when defining these titles, but for the sake of this video, we'll be sticking with the previous moniker. These games often feature extensive move lists, complex combat mechanics, and hordes of monsters for players to slice their way through. Because of the combat focus, the levels will often be broken up into several different arenas, where players must stop and fight an onslaught of enemies before they can continue. These endless waves of opponents should be no big deal for players, however, as you are in control of a veritable one-man army, who is as powerful and skilled as they are outrageously stylish. So how do you pose a threat to someone so unstoppable? Well, for one, bosses often take the form of massive and powerful monsters that tower over our protagonist. This establishes a serious sense of scale, especially when the player is capable of doing this. Wait. Taking down bosses that are not only challenging to fight, but are also visually intimidating, empowers the player and sells the strength of the hero. The satisfaction that comes from taking down a tough boss will be what motivates the player to keep moving forward. This also sets the stage for even greater payoffs with later bosses, thanks to these games' established flow channel. This is a practice in game design that focuses on the balance of difficulty within a game as the player progresses. Maintaining that balance is key, as you don't want players to feel too overwhelmed early on, but you also don't want them to feel overpowered in the late game. So as player skill increases, so too should the difficulty of the challenges they face. This means that if your first boss looks like this, then you know to expect something like this later in the game. But there's also another kind of boss, one that tends to have far more impact on the narrative as a whole, the rivals. These standout characters are your motivators, your raison d'être, your true test of skill. They're just really fucking cool. Rivals tend to be introduced early on as antagonists, with fairly major roles within the narrative. Even if they aren't the main antagonist, the rival character will always find their way back to the protagonist, eager to challenge them at any point in the game. But what makes them so different from any other boss? To put it simply, they're you. No, not literally you. What I mean is, they are the closest thing to your equal that you're gonna find. The player character has done some really outstanding stuff throughout the game, and after overcoming almost insurmountable odds, the player associates a certain level of power and skill with the character they're playing. So what's the best way to put those skills to the test? Try and fight someone who can match you in power and performance. Rivals will often have powers or movesets that mirror the protagonist, and as a result, generally make for pretty tough fights. This gives the player a sense of what they should be capable of doing, which encourages them to improve themselves in the hopes of matching their rival. These fights are the closest you'll come to facing against another player, and by beating them, you establish that you're the superior at this point in the game. That's a pretty high level of satisfaction, but it isn't always easy to establish. The fight against a rival can make or break a game. So next I'll be running through the three major components that make a good rival: how they look, how they act, and most importantly, how they feel. Design is one of the most important aspects of building a character's identity. It's for this reason that such a heavy emphasis is placed on how the hero looks when building a character action protagonist. Since 99% of the game is focused on said character and their actions, you really want to be sure you hit it out of the park from the get-go with a stylish and likable build. The same thing can be said for your rival character. Unlike with the player character, designing the rival comes with a unique challenge. They must mirror the protagonist. From a quick glance, it should be clear that the character you're looking at is not only your equal, but that they also have an important connection to the main hero. So in order to create this feeling, traits that run parallel to the protagonist's must be incorporated into their design, giving them similar body types, fashion, etc. At the same time, it's also important to keep in mind that this is an entirely new character. They have to have their own identity. Striking that balance between what is unique and what is reminiscent is the cornerstone of designing a rival, and it's no simple task. It's for this reason that many games have adopted some standard design practices when it comes to rivals, sort of like tropes. For instance, there has always been a heavy emphasis on the use of complementary colors. Your protagonist wears red, then the rival will almost certainly wear blue. In fact, red and blue are by far the most common colors used within these character rivalries, which makes sense because they are two of the easiest to read. There's also some other connotations to those colors, but we'll get into that in a bit. The classic red versus blue rivalry can be found in characters like Dante and Vergil from the Devil May Cry series, who might as well be wearing matching t-shirts that read, "I hate this guy" on it. This can also be found a bit more subtly in Metal Gear Rising Revengeance, as Raiden has an affinity towards blue lightning, whereas his rival, Jetstream Sam, is more associated with lightning that is red. Not all rivals need to wear complementary colors, however. If one desires, a more clever and nuanced approach may be used, like in the case of Bayonetta and Jean from the Bayonetta series. In Bayo 1, the titular character sports a design that uses black as its primary color and red as a secondary. Jean, on the other hand, has red as her primary color and black as her secondary, which forms an interesting contrast when she faces off against Bayonetta. While reflecting the colors of the protagonist is always a good idea, it's also important to keep in mind what those colors are trying to say. A good rival design should not only mirror the character you're playing as, but it should also inform us about what kind of character they are. With the language of colors, you can do that. Remember how I mentioned the connotations carried by red and blue? Red Oni, Blue Oni is a trope that best summarizes those connotations, as it describes two characters, sometimes rivals, with wildly different personalities that are tied to the colors they are associated with. The Red Oni is typically much more passionate and extroverted, but also a little stupid. Think of them like the right brain or the id. The Blue Oni is far more logical and authoritarian, but they also tend to be a bit of a dick. They're more like the left brain, or your superego. While these are just colors at the end of the day, they can carry a lot of meaning based on what we associate with a given shade or hue. The choice of colors when designing a rival can impact the character as a whole, so make sure you choose wisely. Following color comes shape language, which is another area of design that can tell the viewer a lot about a character without saying a word. Simple shapes like circles, squares, or triangles all have different connotations and can be used together throughout a more complex design to give the viewer a sense of who they're dealing with. Circles tend to be associated with a certain softness and innocence, whereas triangles typically represent movement and power. This is why most JRPG protagonists, like Sora from Kingdom Hearts, have very soft, circular faces with big, spiky hair. From a glance, we can tell that this character is still quite young and naive, but they are full of excitement and eager to explore the world. So how does this apply to our rivals? Well, keeping in mind the different connotations carried by these shapes, we can also see certain shapes oppose one another. Circles and triangles tend to be in opposition, as one is smooth and devoid of angles, whereas the other is all angles and hard lines. If we take a closer look at our rivalries, we can see this shape language at work, like with Dante and Vergil. Dante is always portrayed as having longer white hair that flows down his head in a very smooth shape, whereas Vergil slicks his hair up in a manner that is very angular. Though he is often wild and crazy, from this one example of shape language, we can read that Dante is far more relaxed and easygoing than his brother Vergil, who is immensely powerful and focused on achieving his goals. An alternate example of this would be Travis Touchdown and Henry Cooldown from the No More Heroes series. Travis slicks his hair up, creating a more angular shape, whereas Henry has a shorter and rounder haircut to contrast his brother. This illustrates that shape language is fairly malleable, and it doesn't necessarily indicate good or evil. Travis's triangular hair reads more as a cool and vibrant shape, reflecting the character's personality. Because of the contrasting shapes used, we can also clearly identify Henry as a character meant to oppose and mirror Travis. So like with the colors, creative use of shapes when designing your rival can go a long way towards informing the player about a given character. Last, but certainly not least, there's the body shape and size of the rival. Naturally, if you want to emulate the feeling of fighting your equal, a rival character should be set on the same scale as the character you're playing. Seeing as you've fought countless Goliath-type bosses throughout the game, the impact of this boss requires careful setup with regard to the rival's design. Metal Gear Rising does this quite well, considering that most of the bosses in the game are humanoid cyborgs like Raiden. The size and shape of these adversaries shifts dramatically as the game progresses, and the only character that comes close to matching Raiden is Jetstream Sam. At the end of the day, he has no gimmicks or flashy weapons like the other bosses. He's just a dude with a katana, same as you. So, in summary, a good rival design is mindful of color use, shape language, and body type, as all three can be used to not only mirror your protagonist, but also act as a means of visually describing the personality of the rival. While balancing between the two can be a tricky tightrope to walk, those who manage to pull it off will have a character design befitting of a great rival. Now that our rival has their form, we need to fill this lifeless vessel with some personality. Considering so much of the design process is focused on using visuals to describe our rival's character, you should already have some rough ideas of what sort of person this rival is. As always, keeping their personality antithetical to the protagonist is a good start. Not only does this continue the trend of mirroring the protag, but it also makes for a compelling character dynamic. The Dante we know today is a brash and cocky, but lovable idiot. Whenever he comes face to face with a new foe, there's bound to be plenty of snark from the legendary Demon Hunter, and he gets away with it because his opponents are usually too stupid, or absolutely adore the back and forth and lean into it. Vergil, on the other hand, is cold, ruthless, and incredibly clever. Not only can he match wits with his brother, but he knows exactly how to push Dante's buttons and turn the tables. But personality is only one part of a greater whole that makes up our rival. More than anything, what makes these characters compelling is how they motivate our protagonists. Before we can ever get into the ring with them, we need a reason to go after them in the first place. A carrot at the end of the stick, so to speak. There are two ways to do this, though the effectiveness of these two strategies varies from game to game. The first and, in my opinion, weaker motivator is our backstory. Every character needs a backstory, as it helps root them deeper into the world of the game. For a rival, this backstory can also help connect them to the protagonist in some way. One form this takes is a familial bond, like siblings. Sibling rivalries are iconic and one of the most relatable forms of rivalry out there, so why not give your characters that dynamic? This sort of backstory can establish that the protagonist and the rival share a distinctly passionate bond, and likely have a long-standing history of these sort of squabbles. Because of the blood relation, the player can also intuit that both parties share the same sort of abilities or skills, with the possibility that our rival sibling is even more skilled than the character we're playing as. Naturally, family dynamics aren't your only option. Take the case of Jean from Bayonetta, who is a good friend of Bayo and a fellow Umbran witch. There's also Jetstream Sam from Metal Gear Rising, who doesn't even know Raiden before the events of the game, yet still manages to be an incredibly compelling rival. So while the backstory can provide the player with context, it is ultimately a passive motivator, gently reminding you that the character you're looking at has some sort of attachment to the protagonist. Whether or not the player identifies with this established bond is up in the air, which makes it weaker in my opinion. The second and more powerful motivator is a rival's actions. Actions speak louder than words, as we all know. So when a rival does some outrageously hype shit, you know that you're dealing with someone seriously cool. In a cutscene, spectacle is usually reserved for building character importance, which is why the majority of the cool things you see on screen are done by the protagonist. When another character enters the fray and matches that same sort of intensity and finesse that we see in the protag, they're gonna end up making an impact. That, I feel, is one of the keys to building a truly compelling rival. To inspire a compelling rivalry, you have to make the opponent a memorable badass. There are countless ways to elicit that kind of feeling within a new character, but for a good rival, you'll want to use spectacle efficiently. One of the best examples of this is Devil May Cry 3, as the game does a magnificent job of hyping up Vergil. The first cutscene establishes Dante's character in an entertaining and effective way. All of the wild stunts you see him perform are not only excellent reflections of his character, but they also illustrate how strong the Demon Hunter is. Then, after Dante has fought his first boss in Mission 2, the Hell Vanguard gets away. It flies all the way to the top of the Temen Nigru, where it is swiftly and efficiently destroyed by Vergil. First, this establishes a power scale within the fiction of the game, as Vergil immediately defeats a foe that took Dante significantly longer to beat up. Second, this establishes a power scale within the mind of the player. Someone new picking up DMC3 for the first time might struggle a bit with the Hell Vanguard fight, but it sets a precedent for the game's overall difficulty. Then, after you finally come out on top, in what was likely a messy display of Dante's skills, Vergil comes in and finishes off the Hell Vanguard in a single strike, illustrating that he's not only more powerful than you, but he's also better at this game than you are. The meta-narrative established here, where Vergil is effectively just another player challenging you to rise to their level, is the basis on which all character action rivalries are built. There's another similar moment to this later in the game, following the fight with Beowulf. Only instead of simply showing you that Vergil is stronger than you, the game rewards Vergil's strength in the same way it's rewarded yours, by giving him a new devil arm. This establishes that your rival plays by the same rules as you, and is growing in the same way you've grown throughout the game. A single cutscene raises the bar, encouraging the player to strive to be better. Another effective show of strength is seen in Metal Gear Rising with Jetstream Sam. Unlike Vergil, Sam is a complete stranger to the characters in the game and the people playing at home. Rivaling Raiden is no small task, seeing as Mr. Lightning Bolt has had two games to hype him up already. So MGR gives Sam the spotlight, letting him do the sick stunts and outrageous shit before Raiden can even get out of his suit. Sam is also the first cyborg from Desperado that we get to see. So much like Raiden, we begin to associate Sam with a terrorist organization we're facing up against. To top it all off, after Raiden slices his way through countless lower level cyborgs and single-handedly defeats Metal Gear Ray, he is swiftly beaten by Sam. This exhibits the same power scaling effect we saw in DMC3, but on a more personal level. You are outmatched by Jetstream Sam, and if you are ever going to enter the ring with him again, you need to be better. By putting you in that unwinnable boss fight, the game establishes a serious and personal rivalry that will drive players to reach that desert highway and get the rematch they deserve. Which leads us to the final realm of crafting a good rival. We've seen how to make them look and act the part, but what is a rival without the fight? It's time now to deliver upon all the promises the game has made up until this point. It's time now to see how your rival feels. First and foremost, this fight is going to be hard. It needs to be hard in order to truly make an impact. What would be the point of hyping up your rival throughout the entire game, only to have their fight be an absolute cakewalk? No, these boss battles are meant to be a challenge, a true test of a player's skills. The specifics of that can vary from game to game, like how the fight against Sam in Metal Gear Rising focuses on testing the player's ability to parry, or how the quick-paced battles with Jean from Bayonetta encourage the player to really master their dodge timing. Each character action game is distinct in its own way, so devising a challenge that feels unique and plays into the strengths of a specific title can make or break the encounters with your rival. They can't just be some ordinary boss. They need to be something truly special. Unlike most bosses, your rival needs to be quick and ruthless, with an incredibly diverse move list to keep you on your toes. This is meant to mirror your own quick and intense playstyle, turned against you in this test of skill. If it's been established that your rival shares many of your abilities, then it would be wise to illustrate that in their combat. Jean from Bayonetta is capable of using her own wicked weaves in battle, which the player will immediately recognize from their own experience playing as Bayo. Having recognizable moves elicits that reminiscent feeling one should get when fighting a rival, but it also gives the player a chance to learn from their own failures. Think about it this way. Throughout the course of the game, you've become well acquainted with your move list, learning what works and what doesn't in combat. Generally, by seeing what doesn't work, you would learn how to improve your playstyle in order to thrive against enemies later on. But in a way, these early failures were preparing you for fights against your rival. You identified the gaps and windows in your attacks before, so those same weak points should apply in this setting as well, allowing you to turn the tables on what was once thought to be your superior. But that's just one attack. The move diversity of your rival makes it a challenge to counter all of their attacks, and that's intentional. You, the player, got this far in the game because you knew how to read your situation and vary your moves for maximum effect, and not a single enemy or boss was capable of countering that. It's only fair that you face that same sort of challenge when going up against your rival, but too much all at once can be overwhelming, which brings us to the third major tenet of your rival fight, growth throughout the game. In my opinion, the best rivals are faced multiple times, generally three times for maximum effect. If we consider each of these fights as a test, it would start out with a simple quiz, then move on to the midterm, and finish with the final exam. Your first fight is an introduction to the rival mechanically. They have a watered-down moveset to better reflect the state of your move list this early in the game. Then, the second encounter proves to be a little more difficult, with some new mechanics thrown into the mix for good measure. When you get to the final exam, you should be ready to fully test your skills, as there will be no holding back anymore. Your rival will be using their full move list on top of the mechanics from the previous fights, and they're going to be way beefier than their previous two iterations combined. To paint a better picture of what I mean, let's take a look at Vergil. No, not that Vergil. I'm talking about the original Darkslayer, Nello Angelo. While Nello isn't nearly as mechanically complex as the later iterations of Vergil, he still exhibits the same pattern seen in other character action rivals. You face off against him 3 times throughout DMC1, and each time he's a little tougher than before, with a slightly expanded move list. Most of the moves Nello can do are also mirror images of what Dante is capable of. He's got his basic sword combo, a stinger variant, and high time in your first fight with him. But after you pick up Ifrit in Mission 9, Nello's moveset evolves to mirror this. The second fight with the Black Knight now has additional punch and kick moves, like an uppercut move resembling Magma Drive and a roundhouse kick. In your last encounter with Nello Angelo, nothing is off the table. Here we see the origin of Vergil's summon swords, which are completely unique to him. This is everything you've seen up to this point, plus something new, making for the perfect final challenge before Dante enters the endgame. As time went on, rival battles like this became more and more complex, to the point where it was entirely plausible for these bosses to just be their own playable characters. In a way, that was always the goal, to create a boss fight so challenging, it feels like you're actually sparring against another dedicated player. To truly commit and give these rivals full playability proves that the game isn't pulling any punches. Your rival is as complex and dense a character as the protagonist, equally powerful in every regard. The only difference between you and them is skill. That's what all of this boils down to at the end of the day. If you are capable of facing yourself in combat and you come out on top, then you're the better player. You don't need a fancy diploma or an extravagant reward. Just the knowledge that you're better is enough. So why have I dubbed this the Vergil effect? Why is it that, when the topic of rivals in character action games comes up, Vergil is one of the first to be mentioned? Well, to be frank, it's because he's earned that reputation. Devil May Cry 3 is an excellent game through and through, but it's also a game about Vergil. When that much emphasis is placed on you and your rival, you come to expect a certain level of quality. I don't want to say that Vergil was the first good rival. There's so many excellent video game rivalries out there, and plenty of good character action rivalries too. What makes Vergil so special is the fact that he raised the bar. Post DMC3, character action games would have to work twice as hard to elicit the same sort of emotion and intensity within their rivals, and by extension, their game as a whole. From that competition, new ideas were born, and they became innovative gameplay mechanics that would change the genre forever. When Vergil stepped on the scene, he didn't just challenge Dante to be better, he challenged every character action game out there. Rivalry gives us the chance to prove our worth, to rise to the occasion and be extraordinary. Whether that be two games of the same genre fighting for superiority or two brothers fighting in the rain, it's a compelling narrative tool and an excellent motivator. All of us have the power to be better than who we were yesterday. Sometimes we just need a little push. So I urge you all to find that motivation. Find that rival within you and strive to be better. Once you've overcome that hurdle and faced yourself, you'll be ready to face the world. Thank you for watching this video. It took quite a while to put this one together, so I hope you enjoyed it. I want to give a quick shout out to my good friend Anne Fry, who helped me with all the design stuff I discussed. You can find a link to her personal Twitter and professional Twitter down in the description. If you want to stay up to date on the goings-on of the Digital Dream Club, why not subscribe to the channel and follow us on Twitter, @DigiDreamClub. I hope that you have a wonderful day. See ya!